wonderful people, and welcome back. I think we're all missing the big picture when we discuss the Nimitz UAP encounter. I've spent my entire life as a science journalist, filmmaker, and I think we're asking the wrong question. Throughout the entire history of the US military, the Navy, the Air Force, the Army, the Pentagon have all denied the existence of UFOs, UAP, won't even investigate them, although they're seen all the time. The only definite relationship between the US military and UFOs is disinformation. Security services have used the concept of flying saucers, UFOs, to discredit people who've seen, accidentally, secret military projects. But with the Nimitz encounter, we've all dived into UFOs, all looking for answers from advanced military technology. And we've ignored the question why the Assistant Deputy Director of Information at the Pentagon released the footage. On the surface, it's really embarrassing. Their sightings took place in an MOA, military operational area, carrying out live fire exercises from an aircraft carrier, a big radar oversee from the Princeton. It was a tight ship. And in the past, US pilots, commercial or military, who report seeing UFOs, wouldn't really be taken seriously. They just wouldn't go there. So can we learn something from this? The Navy release forward-looking infrared footage from an F-18 cockpit? They allow the pilots and the crew who saw these objects to talk on national media about them? And for me, the strangest thing is it shows weakness. The US Navy are saying that there was something flying in their controlled airspace that they didn't know what it was. And most journalists are ignoring those strange facts. Why did the US Navy release the footage? What are they really doing here? I don't have an answer, but I think there are some clues from the intelligence agencies. And if I have to flash up one big word, and that is misinformation. Think how much the Nimitz UAP release has cost. The Pentagon, the Navy, everybody involved. It's massive. So in my humble opinion, it's not what it appears on the surface to be. So is it, as Mick West is investigating, just misinterpreted visual information? Do you want to go down the same road as me, saying it's secret military technology? Or did they see something totally out of this world? These are the kind of questions that I like to ask for you. And I'm very pleased to say that there seems to be a whole bunch of new people watching what I have to say on this channel. And because of the nature of YouTube, that you make a film and then it just goes away. And here's a chance for new viewers to catch up. First of all, a film called One Word Plasma. And secondly, a film, Why I Think the US Air Force Aren't Interested in UAP. Trying to research the truth behind military technology and UAP is not really possible on the internet because, of course, it's highly classified and dark secret technology. But I think I found a way through that curtain. Defense contractors in all countries, DARPA in the US, really don't want you to know what they're up to, but they also need funding. So often a very classified project talks in general terms, and also it's associated with a academic university research. So today I'm going to let you into a secret about me and about research. What I'm going to tell you about today is one of the most powerful tools of research that you can use to get behind the curtain. And it's relatively simple. We all want to know the nitty-gritty, you know, who is the company, how does the technology work to project UAPs, visualizations into space. We're not going to find that on a Google search. But what you can do is look at the big picture. Let me explain. So what is the big picture? Well, it's about asking the obvious questions. A good example in the so-called Rendlesham incident, why were only US Air Force personnel affected by whatever happened? Where were the British emergency services, fire, police and ambulance? They weren't there. And in this current debate about UAP, I decided to look at who's doing what. And it's revealed a lot. From universities to defense contractors, they all don't want to tell you exactly the project they're working on, but they all want to boast about the type of technology that they're working on. And what that reveals is very interesting. There are two big funded areas of research: laser-induced plasma, LIP, and a real push into space technology, including bases on the moon. Today for you, I'm going to reveal some of the unclassified, the stuff that they want to tell you about LIP, laser-induced plasma. Universities, defense contractors all over the world are working on laser-induced plasma. So as a catch-up, what is LIP? Well, it's amazing. It's a way of producing a solid object in space. Let me tell you how it works in an unclassified area, and that's astronomy. This is a guide star. This is LIP. This is laser-induced plasma. What happens is that four lasers focus, a bit like shining sunlight through a magnifying glass, to ignite a piece of paper. In this case, the four lasers come to a point and ignite the air. They're orange sodium lasers. Interestingly, and I'll go into this, they're not particularly high powered. You don't need a nuclear reactor or connection to the massive grid. Laser-induced plasma, LIP, doesn't need extreme power, but I'll get back to that in a minute. The four beams focus into a point. They ignite the atmosphere, literally stripping sodium in the air into its ions. It forms a ball, a glowing ball, which is used as the guide star technology, which of course is a spin-off of a military satellite technology, but I think you know that. And if you can produce a glowing ball of plasma, you can produce a glowing dot of plasma anywhere in the sky, and you can steer it around, and through persistence of vision, you can make a volumetric 3D object appear. And you can go out and buy that today. The US Air Force and probably the RAF and probably the whole of NATO use ghost planes. They're countermeasures against incoming missiles, but they also are countermeasures against radar. So you at the back are all shouting, yeah, but plasma doesn't reflect radar. Well, actually, some of it does very badly. Plasma actually absorbs radar energy in lots of frequencies. But there are some types of exotic plasma, people call them dusty plasma, which actually does reflect radar a little bit. And that reveals a massive secret about stealth airplanes. We all are told that stealth aircraft are radar tiny. Possibly a B-2 bomber is the size of a seagull when seen on radar. Why isn't it totally invisible? That is very revealing, because you want it to appear as the same size as your LIP ghost fleet. So you've projected a dozen other bombers into the sky that are visible by radar. They appear very small, but they're obviously a stealthy aircraft. But one of them is real, and you want the real one to have the same radar signature as the LIP, laser-induced plasma ghost ships. That's pretty secret. We are living in a decade where war and military funding is enormous. The stuff being worked on is literally out of this world. You won't believe the type of technology that is around today that you don't know about. Remember the scene out of the classic film The Graduate, where Benjamin is told at the pool party at the beginning of the film, one word.
Just one word.
Yes, sir.
Are you listening?
Yes, I am.
Plastics.
Plastics. Well, you viewers need to know one word to answer a lot of the mysteries that you would like to know about. And that word is plasma. And by asking the big picture, by looking at universities and defense contractors, what they're saying in public, just watch the number of programs that are out there working with plasma. I personally believe that some UAP are man-made. And what we are seeing on the internet, on the media, the so-called Nimitz encounters, are disinformation. They are a classic distraction from the truth. They are there to confuse our enemy and to bamboozle the public. What's really going on is vast amounts of funding into an advanced technology that will change the modern world. I'm going to leave you with some unclassified images that I found by asking the big picture from universities, from defense contractors, all working on plasma technology. The truth is out there. Couldn't resist this updated UAP story. It came from this guy, Christopher Mellon, former Deputy Secretary Assistant Director of Defense. Now not in the Department of Defense, but he asked a really good question about UAPs in the United States. And that question is, why were they only seen and investigated by the US Navy? The US Air Force is in charge of national security in the air and space and has some incredible assets. Let's look today at some of the capabilities that the US Air Force has at spotting an incoming UAP. I think the most famous is this, the space fence that tracks over 25,000 separate space objects. And ever since the Cold War and the Dewline or B-Muse, that's been upgraded to S-Spars, not a cheap supermarket. But the solid state phased array system, let's look at one in detail. While a powerful space fence searches for and tracks objects in space, North America is ringed by a similar massive phased array radar system, primarily to detect incoming ICBMs or cruise missiles. The US Air Force, remember that name, also has the Global Infrasound Acoustic Monitoring Network. This system is comprised of 60 stations in 35 countries to monitor low frequency pressure waves in our Earth's atmosphere. Of course, it was built to detect nuclear explosions, but it can also be used to track objects as they move through our atmosphere and leave an acoustic signature. And probably the biggest US Air Force, I say it again, surveillance system is the Space Surveillance Network. This global program consists of at least 29 distinct worldwide space surveillance systems featuring the world's most powerful radars. Have a look at this one at Elgin Air Force Base, Florida. This is the AN-FPS-85 phased array radar. The US Air Force claim it's the most powerful radar in the world. And I think there's a cultural thing here. If you ask the Americans about the Elgin space radar, they tell you about it, unlike Britain or the Soviet Union. And what they say is this. They say it can, listen carefully, track an object the size of a baseball, you know, cricket ball, at 22,000 miles away. Oh, right. And I believe, because I know Americans, that they're underplaying what it can really do. They tell you its basic capabilities, but its true capabilities are greater. Unlike the Russians, who tend to overblow what it can do, or the Brits, who don't tell you. And then there's a space-based infrared surveillance system looking down in real time for heat signatures from both rocket plumes or even the jet exhausts from aircraft going supersonic. The SBIRS is a network of satellites operating in medium Earth, highly elliptical geosynchronous orbits that together provide continual global coverage of infrared energy sources. And there's more. What about this? This is the Active Electronically Scanned Array, or EASA radars. And what about the Federal Aviation Administration, the FAA? The whole of the US is covered with radars. Today, you actually can't even fly a Cessna without being part of the official notification system. You need to squawk who you are, so unidentified craft are immediately spotted. So let's ask the big question, and it's a good one. And the question is, why aren't the US Air Force, with all these assets that you've just learned about, part of the UAP story? Well, I think there's various possibilities. And I don't shy away from being controversial here. In my humble opinion, and it's way above my pay grade to know, and in fact, I'm not even on the pay grade, wouldn't one answer be the US Air Force don't need to investigate UAPs? Because they know what they are. Why waste taxpayers' money when us, the public, and foreign countries have bought into the whole story of Tic Tacs and UAPs and aliens, when in fact they're an advanced weapon system, well known by the US Department of Defense, so let's just get the Navy to do it. Oh, that was a bit controversial. There are, and I totally love the idea that there's things out there which are unknown. But look at the big picture. These Tic Tac, Nimitz, whatever you want to call them, UAPs, were only seen by the Navy. Only seen in the United States. Only seen in a military operational area that's well known for testing advanced drones. What makes them alien? And I'll leave you with this big question. The US and other nations openly are looking all the time for things that are coming into our solar system. Imagine an interstellar spaceship which enters our solar system, orbits the Earth, and then descends through our atmosphere. Show me that data. Show me the extraterrestrial craft that has approached from afar, slowed down in Earth orbit, descended into our atmosphere to be visible for the whole of humanity. No. Weird UAPs are visible in military operational areas. Okay, sure. Advanced technology, yes. Aliens? Very unlikely. I'm afraid the truth is still out there.